Good evening. Good evening. Welcome to Congressman John Sarbanes' live telephone town hall. In order for everyone to hear tonight's call, you are currently in listen-only mode. For the moment, that means you can hear the Congressman and I, but we can't hear you. This is a live question and answer session with the Congressman. Any topic is fair game, infrastructure, climate change, you name it. If you'd like to ask a question, please press star 3 on your telephone keypad. Once you press star 3, you'll be transferred to a staff member who will take your name, the town you're calling from, and your question. Then you'll enter into the queue to ask the Congressman the question live. I'll now turn it over to Congressman Sarbanes for a brief opening statement.
Thanks very much, Natalie. Good evening, everybody. This is Congressman Sarbanes. This is another in our long-standing series of telephone town halls. This is something I've been doing for 15 years since I came to Congress. It's a great way for me to stay in touch with you and hear from my constituents about what's on your mind, what we're doing in Washington, share good information, sort of current up-to-date state of play on important priorities. It's a terrific way to really stay connected to people in the district. It's interactive, so if you'd like to ask a question tonight, press star 3, as Natalie indicated. Again, star 3 on your telephone keypad. Any topic is fair game tonight. It's open phones in that sense. So if you want to talk about the budget, or you want to talk about infrastructure, or our efforts to deliver important benefits to Maryland families and communities, that's something we can discuss. Climate change obviously continues to be a very important topic, arguably an existential one. It has real impact in Maryland, where we're seeing all kinds of tidal flooding recently down in Annapolis, which is in the 3rd District, and other pressures coming on the Chesapeake Bay and our environment broadly. We can talk about how the jobs component of the infrastructure bill is going to make a huge difference in Maryland and across the country. So again, anything you'd like to talk about, press star 3 on your telephone keypad. We'll try to get to as many people as we can this evening and discuss any issues that you have, questions, comments, suggestions. It's all, as I say, part of the discussion that we're having here this evening over the next hour or so. Let me just make a couple of opening remarks for those that are joining us here on the front end of the call. Obviously, a lot of things are happening in Washington right now. I know that people are paying attention certainly to the significant win we got, victory for the country, really, in the last couple of weeks with the passage of this significant infrastructure investment bill. It's almost unprecedented in its size and scope. $550 billion of new spending on important infrastructure priorities across the country. Roads and bridges, ports, public transportation, high-speed internet, fixing the significant upgrades that we need with respect to our water systems across the country, building resilience to combat the effects of climate change. These are all really important investments. I'm sure we'll talk more about them this evening, but to give you an example what this means for Maryland, in Maryland there's 273 bridges at last count and over 2,200 miles of highway that are in poor condition. This is where the funding from the National Infrastructure Bill will go to help repair those bridges, repair those highways. Maryland's slated to get $4.1 billion for federal aid on highways, another $409 million for bridges. So those are specific examples of what it will mean in Maryland and kind of upgrade our infrastructure broadly. There's a lot of jobs that go with that as well, and we'll talk about that this evening. So if you want to ask a question, again, press star 3 on your telephone keypad. We'll get to you as quickly as we can. Again, if you're just joining, this is Congressman Sarbanes. We're doing another in our series of telephone town halls. Natalie is moderating this evening, so she'll be sort of navigating through the questions and making sure that we stay on task here. But if you'd ask, if you'd like to ask a question, please press star 3. Any topics, fair game. There's a lot happening out there right now. So there's a lot definitely to talk about. I do want to mention a couple other things. We're continuing to work on President Biden's Build Back Better initiative. This would bring really important investments to communities and families across the country. I like to think of it as things that just make it easier for people to get through their day. You know, providing child care, investing in that so that people feel confident that when they leave their children at a child care provider, first of all, that it's affordable. Secondly, that it's high quality. When you head into work that day, you're in a, you know, you have peace of mind. Making sure that we are providing free preschool for every 3- and 4-year-old across the country. In Maryland, that would mean, you know, significant numbers of additional children whose pre-K would be covered in a meaningful way. So, in any event, these are some of the topics that we will cover tonight. Looking forward to the questions. We'll probably intersperse it with some questions we've received ahead of time from constituents, along with people that are joining right now and would like to ask a question. So again, if you wanna connect with us and go live on the call, you can press star 3 on your telephone keypad. Let me turn it back to you, Natalie, and if we've got some live callers, we can go there. We can ask some questions from people who got in touch with us ahead of time.
Sure. Well, we actually do have a couple callers that I know have some questions. So I'm going to have Ted from Annapolis ask his question live. Ted, are you there?
Yes, I am. Hi. Hi, Congressman Sarbanes. Thanks for taking my call. When do you think the Build Back Better Act will be passed, and will it still be strong on climate?
So, as you know, there's been a lot of negotiation. We're trying to reconcile the priorities that we have on the House side of the Capitol with the priorities coming from the Senate side, and it's basically a negotiation among Democrats. My hope is that we can get that done before Christmas. I think that's certainly the intent of the House Speaker and the Majority Leader on the Senate side. We're going to vote, I believe, either tomorrow or Friday on the House version that will go over to the Senate, and then we'll proceed from there. But, you know, what's contained in the bill continues to preserve some very, very key priorities. I was just mentioning a few of them. Affordable child care, high-quality free preschool for 3- and 4-year-olds, making education much more affordable to people by maximizing the Pell Grant awards out there that can be offered to students. That's 85,000 students in Maryland, for example, that would benefit. Worker training, nutrition for children and families across our state and the country. Housing assistance and increasing affordable housing. Now, you asked about climate change in particular. We started with a very broad effort there, which I support because I view climate change as existential here. I mean, everything else we're trying to accomplish, if we can't save our planet, it's not going to matter a whole lot. So we got to make sure that we're focusing in on that. And there will, I think, continue to be very strong elements in whatever bill we get through. The framework that's included there would address issues of environmental justice. It would seek to move us towards these important climate targets that we've set, which is a 50% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions. Below the 2005 levels by 2030, so that remains a very important goal to pursue. Setting up a civilian climate corps that can enlist a whole generation of Marylanders and Americans across the country, conserving public lands, working on community resilience to the effects of climate change, and all of this can help generate very good paying jobs as well. So, it's not going to be as The scope of it's not going to be what the original Build Back Better Act contained, but I do think there will be some very critical and important elements to address climate change contained within the bill. I do want to mention that the Build Back, the infrastructure bill that we passed includes some climate change components as well. For example, making sure that we're boosting the number of electric vehicle charging stations in Maryland and across the country. So there's meaningful things in here. We can always continue to build on it, but I appreciate the question because climate change obviously has got to be a priority, and looking after the environment broadly and the Chesapeake Bay certainly is a priority for Marylanders. So thanks, Ted, for the question. I appreciate it very much. By the way, I was in Annapolis a couple weeks back when the tidal flooding was happening. And so that makes a very powerful statement about why we have got to address this issue of climate change. We're seeing more severe weather incidents occurring across the country and in Maryland. So we know that's a wake-up call to get very focused on this priority. Thanks very much. If you're just joining us, this is Congressman Sarbanes. We're doing another in our longstanding series of telephone town halls. Great way for me to connect with people and hear what you're thinking about and kind of share what's happening in Washington. Hopefully we're doing that in kind of a relaxed, interactive way. So if you'd like to ask a question tonight, you can press *3 on your telephone keypad. Any question is fair game. I'll turn it back over to Natalie to see who's next.
Okay, well, next we have a question from Kevin from Pikesville. Kevin, are you ready to ask your question?
Thank you. Congressman Sarbanes, I apologize. I'm not sure if your committees touch on this subject, but certainly as a member of Congress, you can raise your voice about this. And I am very concerned that unless there are severe, severe consequences for not the QAnon shaman, but for the people who actually plotted this, I'm talking the Giulianis, the Jeffrey Clarks, that ilk, that Claremont law professor, I forget his name. These people laid out a plan to nullify an election and steal our democracy. It doesn't look to me like there's much urgency for punishing that. And if they're not punished, God damn it, it will happen again, and they will succeed. Mm-hmm. This was just a practice run. So I would like some assurance that there will be some urgency directed at laying out just what happened and punishing these people.
Kevin, thanks for the question. I certainly share your concerns here, and I do feel pretty confident, I must tell you, that the January 6th commission that was pulled together and is bipartisan, by the way, and that convened within the last couple of months, that they are very focused on following this thread wherever it may lead. And, you know, there are the obvious culprits that we saw who actually are being prosecuted and being sentenced, who stormed the Capitol. But as you point out, there were people in the background who were helping to facilitate this, incite this, and so forth. Obviously, we have concerns about what President Trump did. That's what the impeachment proceeding was about. But there are others who had a hand in it, and I think the January 6th Commission is in a very kind of straightforward, call it like you see it way, they're going to follow the facts where they lead. An example was recently the other day, they subpoenaed Steve Bannon. He didn't comply with the subpoena, and now there's a grand jury indictment that's flowing from that. So I think you're going to see the law enforcement dimension of this follow through. The other thing is that we have to put broad protections in to make sure that election workers, election officials who are being really demonized across the country, unfortunately, that they're protected against harassment, intimidation, and so forth. the Freedom to Vote Act, which I'm very proud of having helped to shape over the last few years, would not only make sure we have good access to the ballot by the electorate all across the country with, you know, same-day registration, automatic voter registration, 15 days of early voting, no excuse absentee ballot voting, et cetera. But in addition to ballot access, it would also fix partisan gerrymandering around the country, and it would protect against this election sabotage and subversion we're seeing. And it would make sure that election workers and poll workers and officials at the local level are protected against harassment and intimidation, because we see that going on. I don't care whether you're Republican, Democrat, Independent. It's important to respect our basic democratic infrastructure. And every 2 years, we have these amazing professionals across the country who just want to put on a good election. That's what they want to do. And they're Democrats, Independents, and Republicans. There are fellow citizens out there who step up and serve. And we ought to make sure that they're supported, that they're protected, that they're lifted up. That's how we're going to keep our democracy strong. So if we can pass the Freedom to Vote Act, it will accomplish a lot of those things to strengthen and fortify our democracy at this moment where it's kind of shaky, let's face it. It'll also push back against this influence that the big money has on our politics, which really drives me crazy because it gets in the way of the priorities that the public wants to see. You know, reducing the cost of prescription drugs. The pharmaceutical company's always in there throwing their money around, stopping that from happening. So there's a lot of things we can do to make Washington work better, make our politics work better, strengthen our democratic infrastructure. But it includes what you said, which is, you know, if people are trying to undermine our democracy, doing it in ways that break the law, they ought to be accountable. And I think that process is definitely underway right now, both through the Justice Department and through the January 6th Commission. So great question. I appreciate it. Touches on a lot of things, as you can see, that matter to me. If you're just joining us, it's Congressman Sarbanes. We're doing another in our series of telephone town halls this evening. If you want to ask a question, you can press *3. Any topics, fair game. If you'd like to get in touch with my office on a specific matter where you need some assistance, it could be a veterans benefits issue, Social Security, things of that nature, you can always call during daytime hours, 410-832-8890. You can go online. We've got a lot of good resources at sarbanes.house.gov. And if you'd like to subscribe to the Sarbanes Standard, which is the electronic newsletter we put together some years ago and has tens of thousands of subscribers, you can press 1 on your telephone keypad this evening, and we'll make sure we get you signed up for that. So with that, Natalie, why don't we get to our next caller?
Sure. Well, our next caller is Paula, and she's calling from Columbia. So, Paula, are you ready to ask your question?
I'm wondering about Social Security. Hi. Yes, this is Paula. And I'm wondering about Social Security seniors because, yes, we are going to get this 5% or whatever raise, but it's been offset by what they're now going to charge us for our Part B for Medicare. So, and also if you get a supplemental plan, which I'd say probably a good portion of seniors do, that is going up as well. Groceries are going up as well. You know, it's difficult for somebody on a fixed income. So is there anything that can be done? Drug prices are through the roof. I know one of the drugs that my husband takes is outrageous. And, you know, it's a big chunk of the budget.
Yeah, well, let me talk about that, Paula, because it's a great question. I'm sure it's something that a lot of the callers this evening, the people who are listening in, share some of those concerns. First of all, let me take the prescription drug question, because one of the things we're trying to achieve in the Build Back Better Act, which we're going to vote on this week in the House, and hopefully soon we'll get passed in the Senate, and we'll be able to get that signed into law, is to allow Medicare to negotiate with the pharmaceutical industry in a way that can reduce drug prices. This is something we've been trying to do for years. It's part of what President Biden's plan puts forward. I certainly support that in Congress. If we can get it done, it will help bring down the cost of prescription drugs. And that legislation, by the way, also would include an out-of-pocket cap of $2,000 for seniors, which is a pretty big deal because right now the average senior comes out of pocket at about $3,200 a year. So if we can cap that at $2,000, that would mean really significant savings for our seniors. So that's an important piece. The other issues you raised, certainly around Social Security, you're right. There's a 5.9% cost of living adjustment on Social Security for 2022, which is one of the largest adjustments in 30 years. You're right that the Part B premium has also increased for 2022, so that eats away at that a little bit. And, of course, there is some inflation happening now, which makes it hard for our seniors. That's why I've been supporting for years a bill that would require Social Security to compute the cost of living adjustment based on what we call the basket of products that our seniors are dealing with instead of the broad economy. And what we know is that the costs that seniors face are special. It's a special set of costs, and those tend to go up faster than the sort of broader set of expenses that people face out there in the public. So this bill would establish something called the CPI elderly cost of living adjustment formula, and that would make sure that when we're calculating that cost of living adjustment, we're paying particular attention to the expenses that our seniors face. And I think that would result in a more robust adjustment on an annual basis to support our seniors, who obviously in most instances are on fixed incomes, and their dependence on Social Security being there for them in a way that makes a difference is significant. So that's obviously something we have to give real attention to. I support that change, and hopefully we can get that through in the future in a way that makes a difference. But I want to come back and end again on that prescription drug issue, because if we can start to have real negotiation with the pharmaceutical industry through the Medicare program on behalf of our seniors, we can significantly reduce the cost there, which you pointed out can be a real burden for a lot of our seniors across the country and certainly in Maryland. So thanks for the question, Paul. I appreciate that. This is Congressman Sarbanes. If you're just joining us, we're doing one of our telephone town halls, open phones. Any topic is a fair game this evening. So look forward to hearing from you. You can press *3 on your telephone keypad, and we'll get to you as quickly as we can. So why don't we go, Natalie, to our next caller?
Sure. Well, our next caller is A. Nolum from Silver Spring. Are you there to ask your question?
Hi. So thank you for taking my call. This is Emmanuel from Silver Spring. My question is, how is Maryland preparing the workforce to take these trade jobs and technical jobs that will be coming to Maryland associated with the infrastructure bill, especially for our minorities, underprivileged communities? How are we training those for them to grab these high-paying jobs? Thanks for taking my call.
So, Emmanuel, that's a great question, because with all these dollars flowing to Maryland and other states across the country to get these infrastructure projects underway, it raises a question about, will we have the workforce to actually do these projects? I mean, you're talking about a massive investment beginning very soon and continuing out over the next 5, 10, 15 years. So you got to have a qualified workforce. That means you have, I think you invest, and there'll be dollars to do this, you invest in workforce training programs that exist here in Maryland, and there's terrific partnerships at the county level, workforce training centers and development centers and so forth that partner with community colleges, they partner with unions, they partner with various contractor associations and so forth to make sure there's people that are well trained. At the same time, there's going to be a lot of competition for that workforce. And we have to make sure that Maryland's projects are proceeding in a way that allows them to get completed in a timely fashion. So there will definitely be demand for the workers. We got to make sure the training is there. And I think, as you point out, we got to make sure that there's diversity of opportunity there to access those jobs, those work opportunities. And I think that Maryland's in a pretty good place to make sure that we're paying attention to that with the kinds of partnerships I mentioned a moment ago. So that's definitely part of this whole infrastructure investment is related to job creation, but we got to make sure when we're creating those jobs, it reaches all communities in Maryland, that nobody is left out, who has the will, the desire, and can develop the skill set to take these jobs and help us finish these projects. So that's a terrific question. It's something I'm very focused on. I've been very focused on apprenticeships during my time in Congress, very focused on how we boost manufacturing jobs, which will be part of the supply chain that helps with this infrastructure effort. So, you know, you can look at the infrastructure bill as a big upgrade to the roads and bridges and ports and railroads and public transit in America, which it definitely is, or you can just look at it as a really huge jobs bill. And in some ways, that's the bigger impact of it, because good jobs ripple out through communities, make them strong, and lift the quality of life for everybody. So thanks for that question. This is Congressman Sarbanes. We're doing another one of our telephone town halls this evening. Welcome to everybody, including those who may have just joined us. If you'd like to ask a question, you can press *3 on your telephone keypad, and we'll get to you as soon as we can. I do want to mention that if there's a particular issue that you're having where one of my caseworkers could be of assistance to you, by all means, reach out to my office during daytime hours. You can call 410-832-8890. You can always go to my website at sarbanes.house.gov. And if you'd like to sign up for the Sarbanes Standard, which is a good way to keep up with us electronically on sort of what's happening in Washington and what resources are available to my constituents, you can press 1 on your telephone keypad this evening. We'll make sure that you get signed up for the Sarbanes Standard. Otherwise, press *3 if you'd like to join the conversation this evening. And Natalie, let's get the next caller on the line.
Sure. Our next caller will be Chuck from Silver Spring. Chuck, are you ready to ask your question?
Yes, I am. Congressman, thank you for, A, taking the call. B, I wish you and your family a happy Thanksgiving. My question is related to what infrastructure. It seems to me that we're playing catch-up at the worst possible time. And the Bay Bridge, the original Bay Bridge, opened in 52. The second span is in 72. I think the average lifespan of a bridge is supposed to be 40 years. And we're coming at a time now where drivers are relying more on technology and they haven't been driving, so the drivers on the road aren't doing quite as well as they used to. So my question to you is, when will we actually see money that you've just, and I appreciate your efforts in getting it passed, that was just signed, actually literally hit the roads and improve the structures, because it seems like we're playing catch-up.
Yeah. So that money is going to begin flowing in the next 2-3 months, is my understanding. I mean, it's really ready to go out the door, and what that means is states like Maryland, and then within Maryland, different jurisdictions, the counties, Baltimore City, and so forth, they've got projects that are ready to go that can use these dollars. Now, assuming they can find the workforce for it and they can get the contractors lined up those projects can get underway. So I'm very bullish on the fact that people will begin to see these projects rolling out in a way that can make a difference, that can create jobs in a way that also supports, you know, families and communities across our state. You're absolutely right, we're playing catch up. In fact, President Biden's been noting in his speeches over the last couple of weeks that right now the United States is ranked 13th in the world in terms of our infrastructure. For many, many decades, we were ranked at the top, and that was sort of the baseline, the foundation for the economic productivity that we see as a nation. We can't continue to be productive. We can't continue to be competitive if our own infrastructure is crumbling. So we've got to get from 13th up to a much higher position. For example, if we're going to compete with China in an effective way and other countries like that around the world, our infrastructure has to be strong. And that's why this investment was so critical. We've been waiting decades. You know, a lot of presidents have come along and talked about doing investment in infrastructure, and it never happened. I give the president, President Biden, real credit for getting this done, getting it done on a bipartisan basis, making sure that we're actually starting to upgrade broadly across the country, and that includes in the state of Maryland. So I'm excited about it. Now, you know, you'll probably see a lot of projects on the roads and other things that may slow down your commute, but it's all for a good cause, because over time that infrastructure will make all our lives easier. And frankly, it's going to help with the supply chain if we have good, reliable infrastructure. And we've seen in this pandemic, when the supply chain gets kind of choked up, that can create problems in terms of getting products where they need to go, et cetera. So infrastructure is the deal. That's what can strengthen the country, create a lot of jobs, and make us competitive internationally. That's why it was such a key priority for the president and for members of Congress. So thanks very much for the question. This is Congressman Sarbanes. We're doing a telephone town hall tonight. If you'd like to ask a question, you can press *3. You can always go to my website and get information on what we're doing in Washington at sarbanes.house.gov. And feel free to call my office during daytime hours at 410-832-8890 if there's something we can help you with specifically involving veterans benefits, Social Security, Medicare, any of the things that involve federal agencies. My responsibility to help you with those challenges and those issues, so please do not hesitate. Natalie, who's our next caller?
Okay, well, up next we have Maureen from Baltimore.
Yeah.
Maureen, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. Thank you so much for calling me up. And Congressman, I appreciate that you're giving us this opportunity to voice our concerns. I am very concerned about how all the restrictions that have been put in place over the COVID pandemic seem to be continuing on and on and on, and I don't see that they've been helping people. We're still, I've been in other states, they've already removed masks, they let kids learn in school, they let a lot more freedom of the kind of freedom that we once were acquainted with, that we knew, but in Maryland, we seem to be stuck in this time warp. Why am I saying this specifically? Because my elderly father was keeping all the rules that they required, the lockdown, the isolation, the mask, and we saw a steady deterioration. Finally, 2 months ago, we said, enough of this. We took him out, we stopped everything, and then he made an amazing recovery. He came back to life, he was happy, he was doing well. We've had, you know, Einstein has said that the definition of insanity is to keep doing the same thing and expecting different results. We've been masking up for 2 years. We've been seeing surge after surge after surge. We haven't seen that these things have helped us anymore, that they've helped Maryland have a much lower COVID rate than anywhere else. So when are we going to be able to come back to normality? When are we going to be able
Well, Maury, yeah, I mean, it's a fair question. I know it continues to be frustrating for people because there's no quick or easy way out of the pandemic. I mean, you know, things, as we've seen from the beginning, things kind of, the terrain shifts, things change from 1 week or 1 month to the next. I think broadly speaking, if you look at your elected leaders, whether it's at the national level with President Biden, members of Congress, or at the state level where a lot of these decisions get made, they're trying their best in most instances to balance all of these different precautions. When it comes to mask wearing, I know, for example, today or yesterday, the Maryland State Board of Education had a meeting where they invited public input. I actually used to work with the State Department of Education, so I'm familiar with that process, and ask people, parents, to come in and sort of explain their perspective on mask wearing for young people in schools. And I think there's still good arguments to be made, depending on where you are and what the infection rate is, and what the particular experience is in a school district, that's an appropriate precaution to take. What we do know is that getting people vaccinated and now making sure that those booster shots are getting into people's arms is absolutely critical if we're going to keep the pandemic at bay. So since you've brought up the topic of COVID, which I think obviously continues to be on people's mind, the fastest way back to, quote, normal or a new normal is to get, again, as many people vaccinated as possible, and then to take advantage of the booster shot when it's appropriate, because the science is telling us that that can be very, very important. The other thing I want to encourage people on the line, as long as we're talking about health here, we are expecting that the flu season this year could be pretty severe. And so at the same time, people are out there getting their booster shots or getting maybe their first vaccination shots for COVID. Please also take advantage, particularly our seniors, of the opportunity to get the flu shot, because that will help protect you this winter. So, you know, we got to keep our eyes open. We got to be vigilant. We got to, even though everybody's got different perspectives on this, from one family to the next, you know, people got their own opinions about how many precautions should be taken and all that kind of stuff. I get that. I understand it. The one thing we got to try to do is stick together as a community here in Maryland, lift each other up, rely on each other, support each other as we're making our way through this health crisis. So thank you very much for your question. Why don't we go right to our next caller, Natalie?
Sure. That's Rob from Glen Burnie. Rob, are you there?
Yes. How you doing?
Good.
Thank you for taking my call. My question's about unemployment, myself included, and I know of a lot of other people that have still been waiting for unemployment benefits to be paid after months of waiting. There's no answers they're giving us. They just say we have to wait for a phone call from adjudication, something like that. What else can a person do to get answers
Rob,
for unemployment?
Yeah. Rob, I know how incredibly frustrating this is. I've talked to many Marylanders who are in a similar situation. We have been doing our best to push hard on the state of Maryland, on the governor, on the department that handles the unemployment benefits, to process this more quickly, to try to break through this adjudication backlog. We will continue to do that. We don't have, at the federal level, we don't have direct control over that process, because even though we provide a lot of the funding, the mechanics of how it's done happens at the state level. I don't offer that as an excuse for anything. That's just an explanation of how the process works. But we will continue. I know that my colleagues in the Maryland delegation, the federal delegation, have been making strong arguments about this, and making sure that we are transmitting the complaints to the governor's office. So we will absolutely continue to do I can tell you that we've had a lot of inquiries at our office about this. And, you know, if you'd like to contact my office, we will do what we can to answer any questions you have and transmit your particular concern to the state officials that have responsibility for this. But I know how frustrating it is. I mean, I've heard from many people about this. It's frustrating for me because we provided a lot of dollars to help people with their unemployment benefits. And then there was, you know, these backlogs and bottlenecks in terms of actually getting it out the door or getting the adjudication process that you're talking about to be more streamlined. So we're going to keep working at it. I know that's not a great answer for you, Rob, if you're contending with this, but please know that we've heard that concern. We're working as hard as we can to transmit it to the appropriate people. And again, if you need assistance, don't hesitate to reach my office. You can go online at sarbanes.house.gov. All the information on how to contact us is there. So appreciate your question. Again, this is Congressman Sarbanes. We are coming up, you know, I guess we got about 15 minutes left in the telephone town hall tonight. It'll be an hour that we will been in conversation with constituents from across the 3rd District. So if you'd like to ask a question, you can press *3 on your telephone keypad. We'll try to get to you as quickly as we can. If, as I say, you want to reach out to my office, you can always call 410-832-8890 if you have a particular issue you need help with from one of our caseworkers. We'll do what we can to help you if you call during daytime hours. If you'd like to sign up for the Sarbanes Standard, which is our electronic newsletter, you can do that by pressing 1 on your telephone keypad. We'll make sure we get you signed up. We have tens of thousands of people that subscribe to that. It's a good way to keep up with what's happening in Washington and get some good information. So, Natalie, let's get to our next caller.
Okay, our next caller is Sandra from Owings Mills. Sandra, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. I wanted to thank you, Congressman, for all you do. I know how hard you work on our behalf. I am calling about H.R. 1, which I know is very near and dear to your heart, and pretty much is the Republic right there. Just wanted to know what the status of this most important bill is, and if you see any daylight coming through now on getting this thing resolved.
Yeah, thanks very much, Sandra. You're absolutely right. This is something I've been working on for a long, long time, very intensely over the last year or two. And this is to put in place these efforts to strengthen our democracy. Because as I said earlier in this call, we can just look at it. We know things are kind of shaky right now. So H.R. 1, which was the bill I helped to assemble in the House of Representatives over two Congresses, last Congress and the Congress we're in now, we got H.R. 1 passed in the House. That was the For the People Act. In the United States Senate, there's a newer version of the bill called the Freedom to Vote Act, which was introduced by a group of Democratic senators. And that has all the real critical elements that were part of H.R. 1, so I feel really good about that legislation. If we can get it over the finish line, it makes sure there's access to the ballot box, that it's convenient for people to register and cast their vote. It makes sure that we're fixing partisan gerrymandering across the country by having really good standards in place that respect the voters and respect the public. It addresses this new threat we're seeing that has to do with election subversion. This is where, you know, local election officials can be just removed without notice, where the vote count can be undone. It's really a dangerous thing we're seeing, and we want to also protect election officials from harassment and intimidation, so we've got provisions in there that would achieve that. It protects us against foreign interference in U.S. elections, which obviously we need that kind of protection given what we've seen over the last few years. And it pushes back against the influence the big money crowd has. Every American knows that the insiders with money and checkbooks and lobbyists have too much sway over how decisions get made in Washington. And it seems like the average person's always being left out. You know, whether it's Wall Street writing tax policy or Big Pharma deciding prescription drug prices or, you know, inability to get reasonable gun safety measures in place that are important to people because the gun lobby has too much influence. All those things, or addressing climate change is difficult if the fossil fuel industry has too much influence. So if we're going to get good public policy that respects voters out there, including people who live in Maryland, we got to push back on the money crowd and insiderism in Washington, and this bill would do that. So where does it stand? I'm hoping in the next few weeks, before the end of the year, the Senate can find a way to change the rules so that we can have a simple up or down vote on that bill in the United States Senate. And I think it can happen. And what I think will be determinative is the public has continued to show up every day saying, we want our democracy to be strong. Everything in that bill, Sandra, is not controversial. Democrats, Republicans, independents, the polling shows support these common sense things. They want to be able to vote without it being a hassle. They want to feel respected when it comes to how congressional district lines are drawn. They want to protect election officials who just want to put on a good election every couple of years. And they want to fight back against this influence that money has on our system. That's supported by people of all political stripes. So we need to get it done in Washington. We passed it in the House. We got to get it passed in the Senate. I think it can happen in the next few weeks. But please continue to beat the drum on this, because it's been the public's pressure that's made all the difference. Again, if you're just joining us, Congressman Sarbanes, we're coming up towards the end of our hour telephone town hall here. So I'm going to see if I can get maybe another two or three questions. We'll see what Natalie lets me do. But why don't we go right to our next caller, Natalie?
Well, our next caller is Howard from Owings Mills.
Okay.
And he will be here. Howard, what's your question? Howard, are you there?
Yeah, I just need to turn the mute off. Yes, I'm here. John, you've been incredibly fortunate. You got a chance to go into your father's business, and he had a fabulous reputation that I'm sure you're proud of. He provided you with private schools, top universities, and all that, but the Democrat Party, the time he was in it, was still the party of Kennedy. Now it's the party of AOC. So I'm curious as to why a person in your position, I believe you have three children, that you're going to stick them with the, these bills are going to be paid for. And just so I'm clear, I spent over 40 years as a registered Democrat. I haven't voted that way in 30, and I won't vote for any Democrat going forward. These bills are a sham. You do a wonderful job of talking about all the, you know, the big fine, you know, points that everybody wants to hear, but you don't talk about all the tricks and gimmicks that are in the bills. Green energy tax credits and $42 billion in subsidies for the rich through green energy tax credits for electric vehicles. The salt tax that's going to go from $10,000 up to what I believe $70,000 or $80,000. Who does that benefit? Benefits the rich. Nothing is free, as Bernie would like to say, and yet you're promoting free community colleges, putting most of the, at least half the bill on states. There's no mention of what's going on in the border and these midnight flights that are bringing illegals here. We're going to have about 2 million illegals crossing the border that they know about, plus God knows how many that they don't know, the gotaways. They've got 150 or 60 countries, people from different countries that have come across the border. They've caught people on the terrorist watch list coming across the border. Why don't we talk about some of those things? I mean, it's nice to...
Well, let me respond to that, because obviously, Howard, you know, we've got some different perspectives on things. I respect that. I can't expect everybody in my district, and certainly everybody who comes on this call, to share my views on things. But I do believe that the way I've presented these investments, whether it's the infrastructure investments, what we would try to achieve through the Build Back Better Act in terms of making it easier for families to afford child care, make sure that, you know, that preschool is there for 3- and 4-year-olds, help lift the burden, the debt burden that often falls on those who pursue community college or higher education. Those are all real things, and I think that we've developed a national response to those that can make a very, very important difference. You mentioned, you know, my own children, they all went through public schools in Maryland. I believe very strongly in the value of keeping public education high quality for everybody in our state and, frankly, across the country. I did a lot of work in education in a prior life, so I've seen the value of that. So I don't view this as gimmicks. I think it's real, and frankly, the return we'll get on this investment will pay us back in spades. All of the economists' estimates about it show that we'll get a good return on this investment. So anyway, I appreciate you have a different view on some of these things. We're going to keep doing our best and making the best call we can. In my judgment, these are important investments that can make a difference. And make a difference, just again, as I always say, just helping people get through their day in a productive fashion, be able to lift their families up, have the benefits they need, a good job, and the stability that comes from that. So that's what this is all about. Let's go to our next caller, Natalie, because I want to see if we can get one or two more in before we have to close down here.
Sure. Well, Marty from Rosedale is our next caller. Marty, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. Congressman, it's glad to speak with you. I appreciate the opportunity. I was going to ask you about dental coverage for Medicare. It's never been covered, and the problem with dental is an elderly person can take care of themselves, eat the right foods, get exercise, whatever, but there's nothing they can do to prevent their gums and their teeth from getting old. Now, if a person goes to a dentist, they are not going to be covered under the Maryland Medical Guide. This is just for Maryland. I don't know about other states. So if you go to 3 different dentists, you're going to get 3 different prices for a procedure. It would be really great if dental would be part of Medicare. Has anyone ever considered this?
Absolutely, they've considered. In fact, the original proposal that President Biden put forward in Congress for the Build Back Better Act included dental benefits. Now, that's something that may not survive the negotiation here, so it may get pulled out. There was dental benefits, there was vision benefits, there was hearing benefits. I think the hearing benefits, the coverage for hearing aids and that sort of thing, we're trying to keep that in the bill. So that's important. But I agree with you 100%. You know, Elijah Cummings, who left us a couple of years ago, that was a passion of his, making sure that, in that case, that Medicaid covered dental benefits. He worked very hard on that. But absolutely, our seniors need access to benefits for dental health, because it affects everything else. We know that physical health often flows from good sort of dental hygiene and being able to look after dental health. So I'm going to continue to push very hard for that, because I think it can make a huge difference in people's lives. It's a very, very important benefit for our seniors. It's something the president wanted to get through with his proposal. I'm not sure it's going to be included in the final version, but that doesn't mean we can't keep fighting for it. We absolutely will. Natalie, do we have time for one more caller?
I think we can do one last caller, and that's going to be Alexis. Alexis from Laurel. Alexis, what's your question?
Yes, hi, thank you. And I wanted to say thank you first for having this forum. This is a great way to feel really connected with you and the community at this time. I just wanted to ask a question on behalf of myself and, you know, other people in my situation. I am a federal employee, and I have been, you know, mindful of all of the masking regulations and socially distance and all of that. And I work from home, and I contracted COVID when my son went back to school and got it from another student and brought it back to me in September. And I am still being treated for some of the longer-term conditions that I've incurred from having the infection. And I'm glad that I'm still here, not dead. And my question was, what type of support are available for us as federal employees? Because I've been working for the government for over 15 years, and I actually have an occupational disease with my hands that was caused by me literally working my fingers to the bone in the agencies that I've worked for. I have sought, like, you know, medical exemption because I don't really understand all of the guidance that seems to keep changing a lot that's coming from the CDC. So I'm not really even clear on whether or not I'm supposed to be vaccinated if I'm still having like symptoms. But I do have some allergies that pose a really serious risk for me, and I have sought an exemption for that. And I just feel extremely vulnerable at this time because I do work in a very technical field that is like a hard to staff area. And, you know, I have been like the first graduate out of my family from college and have really, you know, pulled myself up and worked really hard and, you know, made a sacrifice to come into public service and foregone like additional compensation that some of my colleagues easily get, you know, for a career in public service. And it's just very disappointing to think that